And I want to start out by clarifying, there are two Volvos here. There used to be one, now there are two. One makes automobiles, one makes trucks and marine equipment. The one that is publicly traded is the truck one. This is the car one, which is a private company owned in China. Is that correct?
That is exactly correct, yes. That's the one that's going to be producing these vehicles for Uber. And as you say, there's about 24,000 of them. And they actually started testing these last year in Pittsburgh. They had a driver sitting in the front seat just to sort of make sure that everything was okay in the instance that something did go wrong. But for all intents and purposes, they were fully autonomous. And certainly that's what Uber's planning on these 24,000 vehicles to be as well.
So, Nate, one of the things I find interesting is they're talking about SUVs and things like that. A lot of what we've heard about would be smaller vehicles for urban centers that the other automobile companies are going into for driverless. What is the theory here of Uber?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, to be honest, at the moment, I'm not entirely sure that we know, other than the fact that these are vehicles big enough to have a lot of the technology fitted to them in order to make them fully autonomous. They have a lot of tech in them. They have radar, they have lasers, they have cameras, they have GPS. They need to have a lot of room for passengers as well. So the bigger cars are actually more beneficial for this kind of testing at the moment. And certainly that's what they've been using, the very same model, in fact, last year. So they're sort of continuing that so far.
Can we read anything into this acquisition from what the success is they've had in the test? Because as I recall, they actually had an accident early on in Arizona with one of these.
Yeah, they have had accidents, and a lot of these systems have been reported to have accidents. You know, Uber's doing this, but Google's testing autonomous vehicles as well. There's a lot of companies doing this. And essentially what they have to do is they have to sort of embrace that and say, okay, what went wrong? What happened? Can we make this better? Because part of the problem with autonomous vehicles that we're going to see is that when an accident happens, there's going to be so much attention on how it happened, why it happened, and kind of with whom the blame lies. You know, there's even a moral question to be asked about if one of these cars is in an accident, you know, who's at fault? Is it the software that's powering the vehicle? Is it the vehicle's manufacturer? Is it whoever's operating the car remotely, perhaps? So many questions to be asked.